at a Christmas party when she saw a biography on John Dodge, the wealthy automobile maker. She was astonished by the similarity between Dodge's photo and her own mother, Pat.
I could see my brother's face and my mother radiating from the page. And it was as if I was in a time warp.
Further research uncovered more likenesses between the families. Pat feels that her son William bears a striking resemblance to Horace Dodge Jr., and that her daughter Sharon could have been the twin of John Dodge's granddaughter, Frederica.
And I really got the chills when I saw John Dodge's face. I really did. And when we turned to the back of the book and I saw people's names that were friends of my father's, then I really thought this must be something to this.
Pat discovered that a man named Frank Upton had been a close friend of her father, Robert Manzer, and she remembers the Uptons visiting her home regularly.
Frank Upton also worked for John Dodge in a very personal capacity. He manages business affairs. We suspect that he probably arranged the adoption.
Curiously, around the time of Pat's adoption, the Manzers enjoyed a sudden increase in wealth. The loan on the Manzer home was paid off in cash. Mrs. Manzer started wearing mink, and Mr. Manzer began driving the first of many brand new Dodge cars. Pat filed a claim to the Dodge family's $40 million fortune and asked the courts to open her adoption records. Both requests were denied.
I think it would only take 5 minutes for some judge or lawyers or whatever to look at the papers and just tell us one way or another.
Pat appealed the court judgments, and just a few months ago, a new ruling said that her adoption records would be made available. And just a few days ago, Pat saw her adoption papers for the first time. Lansing was something of an ordeal for you, wasn't it?
It certainly was. We went up there to see the head man up there, and he said that he would... We called him on the phone. He said he would see us and he would show us the paper. So when we got there, he didn't come out to see us. He sent his secretary. And when she brought the papers out, she just showed them to us. And she said, well, you won't be happy with this. And she said, I'm not. And she said, just look at the difference. And we didn't really see it till Channel 7 put it on the news that night. Mike Holfield put it on. And when they blew it up against the screen, we could see all the writing underneath, and there was no last name. There was nothing on it.
The names and were if they erased would have, and written over?
If they'd have just said, well, your birth certificate isn't here, I'd have gone home happy, really, because I figure they could have lost it in 75 years, you know. But when they handed me such a phony, I wouldn't... This is the first time I've ever felt like fighting this. The first time.
We have a copy of this record there. Now, that's the upper part of the state certificate written in 1914.
Mm-hmm.
And there you can, I don't know if you can tell it here, this is a photostatic copy, so its colorations are reversed, white on black to black on white. But if you look at the name, viewers, you can see it looks like there's something foggy.
It's been erased. The woman at Lansing even said it had been erased. Mm-hmm.
And there's another thing, too, here. There's some fiddling with the date. The alleged birth date.
Mm-hmm. I have three birth dates now.
Which one do you like the best?
Well, I...
Did you say why they wouldn't let you... Did they say why they wouldn't let you look at the papers?
Well, they said we needed a court order to look the original. We got the court order, and that's what I took for granted we would see would be the original.
Never
but
did.
They wouldn't show them to us. They said I'd have to go to court again to get a court order to look at the original.
Also joining us are two very important people in the case, Pat's daughter, Sharon Stajda, and Dodge biographer, Jean Mattern Patron. Welcome them all to Kelly & Company. Why do you feel that you were not allowed to see the original document?
Well, I believe the document was in such bad shape. I had talked with Mr. Copeland, he's the assistant registrar, the morning we went up to Lansing, and he was looking forward to meeting my mother and meeting with us. When we reached the office in Lansing, like my mother said, the secretary came out. I did request at that point that we meet with Mr. Copeland, that he was mm-hmm. expecting us. She said that she would be handling it. And we gave her our court order. She went back, I assume, to Mr. Copeland, showed him the court order, and brought us out the birth certificate. You could visibly see that it was erased. Things were written under the name of the mother and the child. The date was, you can see, tampered with, and it gives another, as far as place of birth for Emma Jane, it gives another place of birth other than the adoption record. So right away I was thinking, this birth certificate just does not look in order. So we requested to see the original. They did refuse to show us the original document.
What do you think they're hiding?
Well, it's hard to say. I believe my mom's the daughter of John Dodge, and I believe that's what they're hiding.
There are really, I guess we can say there are four scenarios here. One, that you are a Siamese twin.
I never did say Siamese. That started in the Inquirer, I think, but I believe I'm a twin.
Okay, but isn't there something to do with the
yes,
scar?
Yes, I have scars on the back of my head.
And was there any proof that that was caused after birth, that scar?
It must have been caused. It must have been caused at birth, but my mother told me I had received it from falling down. And when I had Sharon in the hospital, my doctor, he said, where'd you get those scars? And I said, well, my mother said I fell down the steps when I was small. And he said, well, those aren't fall down the step scars, they're surgical. And that's the first time I knew it, when she was born.
Did the so-called Siamese twin have a scar? Was it ever known if Frances
Well, died? Some say she did, some say she didn't. So I don't know.
Jean, you have a story in the book that, let's see if I can get it straight myself. The daughter of a nurse that the Dodge daughter had said her mother told her there were scars on the daughter. Do I have it right?
Yes, the attorney told me this. He said that a nurse for Frances Dodge had confided to her mother that she saw a scar on Frances Dodge, right at the top of her shoulder. And it looked, she said, like a burn scar. The mother called the attorney to report this, but when he tried to get in touch with the daughter for verification, she couldn't be reached. And that was the end of that. The mother would not give out her new address. The nurse was never heard from again.
Now, the other scenario is that you are the daughter of Emma Nelson, who was the Dodge maid, or one of the Dodge maids. Can you elaborate on that? Why is that one of the possibilities?
Well, I found the name Emma Nelson years before anything had anything to do with Dodge. I had a friend, Helen Burns, that was a friend of the judge downtown, O'Brien, and she called him and talked to him. He said, well, he'd show me my papers, so I went down. And when they took me in an office, and then they said, well, they'll just show me the back page. Well, at the bottom of the back page, I saw Emma Nelson. So I told my family, and we figured it could be a secretary or something. You know, I wasn't really even interested that time. It was shortly after my father died. And I had a good family. My mother and dad were real, real good people. And I wasn't that interested, but the children wanted to know who their grandparents would be and mm-hmm. find out. So they started searching, and they did search for years before they ever came onto the...
Jean, do you think that could be?
Yes, well, we did a little research on that. I went down into the city directories at Burton Library, and I found an Emma Nelson in 1914 who was working as a domestic. But in 1915, she had disappeared from the Detroit area. Evidently, at least, she was no longer listed in Detroit. So then later, Mrs. Mealbach's daughters, I believe, looked up the census records and found that in 1910, Emma Nelson was working at a very young age, evidently. But then youngsters did go out to work at a very young age then. Was working at the Dodge East Boston Boulevard home in 1910. So
this is the piece of implications.
Oh, the other one that's fraught with implications is the next one, Amelia Rauch, which is Matilda's the sister. Yes. And that is interesting because I was reading where there was a connecting door between John Dodge's bedroom and the sister of Matilda, Matilda, and Matilda was always a little jealous of that situation.
A little.
Okay, you want to elaborate on that? Maybe Sharon? No.
Sharon.
Well, Jean could probably elaborate more because she's done so much research on the John Dodge family, but I was able to get into the farmhouse, and yes, there was a connecting door between John Dodge's bedroom and Amelia's. Also, when Dodge...
Sharon. Yeah. Farmhouse.
Farmhouse.
People say, what? Farmhouse? Where the hell did that come from? We went from Boston Boulevard to farmhouse. What farmhouse?
John Dodge had a secondary home. It was a farm that built out at Meadowbrook, where Meadowbrook Hall now stands. In fact, this farmhouse still stands. Yeah. It's been recreated into offices at this point. But yes, there was a door that were attached. Also, Amelia was given quite an expensive, elaborate ring by John Dodge. I believe it was in 1912, a $5,000 ring. Mm-hmm. When his wife, he got a large settlement through some court dealings with Henry Ford. He won some type of a court settlement. And at that point, he gave Amelia this beautiful ring, and his wife, he gave $1 million check. So I don't think that would sit, I know it wouldn't sit well with me.
Sorry.
I think it was possible because I think Amelia was a social climber that she wanted, Matilda. And I think Amelia was more fun and outgoing, and she liked to, she was a different kind.
Did John Dodge kind of run around, Jean? Was he noted for being kind of a...
Yeah, he was noted for a lusty appetite filled just about in every direction. The little sister Amelia, she was the only sister of Matilda, and they were very close. Until in 1914, she was banished to live out at Meadowbrook at the farm. It was then Meadowbrook Hall. It was not built, of course. She was to live at the farmhouse and take care of the farm. And some people find this very coincidental, that she was sent away at this time. And then, of course, Frances Mealbach and Frances Dodge, I say the real heiress, but maybe recognized heiress is a better term, were born in 1914. I don't know about that, but there are, you know, a lot of coincidences to support this.
Because the other one is just, you're a twin. You're a fraternal twin, right? Do you think that's...
Yeah, the other one, they could be fraternal twins.
Why would they...
Marilyn, I've got to interrupt you.
Why would they get rid of one and keep the other? What...
Well, I think I was, in fact, I know I was very ill when I was born, and we don't know what happened to me from November till about March.
So you think they kept the healthy one?
Uh-huh. I think maybe they thought I'd be retarded or I might die, you know.
In those days, they had different ideas.
Oh, yeah.
Siamese was not really, mm-hmm, especially mm-hmm. if you were rich and mm-hmm. famous, you did not want to have a Siamese
no.
child twin.
No, dear, we've got to
on
take the
to, never mind.
Got to take
I'm
the break.
Busy doing this.
This is why our commercials run so close together at the end of the show, honey.
I find it so fascinating.
But as Jean, you pointed out, there are just many, many coincidences. We're going to continue to pursue those and talk about them through the program today. But what we're saying and hearing, I think, is what is needed now, because we're almost, you are almost at the end of, the trail. The options are narrowing. And what you'd like to do is for our family members, our friends that you have yet to hear from, come forward and say, now I know this about that. What we are doing on Kelly and Company is kind of open our telephone lines to just such people. Our number, our standard number here is 298-6161. Particularly to people who may have been friends or know about Emma Nelson. So we understand that Emma could have taken up residence in Jackson, Michigan, maybe in Windsor, Ontario, maybe elsewhere. And she did apparently marry a man named, get this name down here, this is where my problems are coming from, Ethan Kimball. Then there was a family by the name of Ferguson. And the Ferguson family may have some information about Emma's disappearance. So if you are a member or of the family, maybe a friend of the Nelsons, or you know something about Emma Nelson, or the Kimballs or the Fergusons in Jackson or Windsor, or whoa, this is going on. Give us
Emma
a
be?
Call at 298-6161, and we'll be right back after this. Marilyn. Thank you. Before we go any farther, I think we should point out here that our producers made every attempt to contact the Dodge attorneys and telling them what we mean attorneys, phalanxes of them, yes. And they had no comment, and they would not take part in this program.
Now, do we have everything straight? We have all the scenarios straight, right? Okay, just kind of briefly going over them. She could be Tech, could be a Siamese twin, divided at birth or after birth, could be the daughter of John Dodge and Emma Nelson, who was the Dodge maid, right, Jean? Or could be the daughter of Amelia Rausch, who was the sister of Matilda. Something going on behind closed doors there. Or could be just a fraternal
twin.
Fraternal twin.
Okay.
Very well indeed. I think what's very amazing is the family resemblances when I looked at the pictures in the book between John Dodge and Pat. You want to, let me see the picture. There's John.
All right, watch this dissolve. The dissolve from this picture of John Dodge to you, Pat.
Yeah. Isn't that?
Strong family. Look at the split screen.
What's even more amazing, I want you to look at the children. How much the members of the...
Oh,
there's the sister.
Pat, that's an older photograph of you there.
Mm-hmm. Now, let's look at the children, the members of the family, how much they look alike. At Sharon's picture next to John Dodge's granddaughter, Frederica. Right? Next, we have your son, William. That's your son, Pat. And his resemblance to Horace Dodge, Jr. Wow. Isn't that unbelievable? And that's you?
Yeah.
Now, I think there's another picture of you and, well, we'll get to that, I think, in the next segment, of you and Francis Dodge, which... Yeah. There's the picture of the two. And there's another picture coming up of the two of you were taken together, and you were sort of an unidentified...
You don't
there
know.
There it is. Okay, now I want you to look at something here. I don't think anybody's seen this. Well, you notice the girl on the right side of your screen is supposed to be you, Pat. Is that right?
No, I'm on the left.
You're on the left, okay.
We and don't Francis, know who's on the right.
We don't know who's on the right. But both little girls... have the same material. Their clothes are made of the same material. Did you notice that, Jean?
Oh, yes. They're dressed.
Now, why would another unidentified little girl to the right or left be in the same outfit? Somebody must have made those outfits together.
Well, of course, we have our own. Lisa can surmise about that. But she was told, of course, it was just a little girl called Amy. She was told this by her mother. And that was never elaborated on further. But... It's highly unusual.
You're almost dressed as twins.
It was given to me just before my mother died. I'd never seen it before. But before she died, she gave it to me.
You didn't even know that your real name was Francis until you were 27.
Well, I never knew I was adopted until I was...
After your father died. That's when you discovered your name was Francis?
Yes. Mm-hmm.
That's when you...
No, I discovered before that when I applied for a driver's license that they sent me from Michigan, from the driver's license bureau. My name was Francis, and I said, well, there's a mistake on this, you know. And they said, oh, there isn't, but I just let it go because it didn't matter.
When did you finally get your birth certificate?
I got it a week ago or 2 weeks ago. 2 weeks ago.
Mm-hmm. What do they show? Do they show that Dodge heiress Francis Matilda Dodge? I don't know. You tell me. I'm going to get confused.
Tell them about the one we sent for and got.
There was a mix-up.
Okay. In 1984, we were really, me and my sister and my mother were greatly into this research. So when we obtained this new name, Francis, we thought, well, maybe at this point we're going to have a chance at getting a birth certificate from my mother finally. So she sent all of her names. She's accumulated quite a few by this time in history. And her mother called her Lucille, also called her Peggy for unknown reasons, also called her Patrick. So now we have a new name. So she put this whole list of names, Manzer, Mealbach, and the state sent back a certificate of Francis Dodge to my mother, firstborn of twins.
Incredible.
We returned it thinking, well, I mean, we were already on the Dodge trail at this point, thinking this is what it was. This more or less confirmed it in our own minds. At that point, we obtained an attorney, you know, when something like that would happen. But we were flabbergasted, so we got
Did you keep that, or did you say this is an error? Well, we sent it back,
and it was, what happened, we sent it back, and we kept copies of it. You know, we sent the original back because we found that it was against the law to have other people's birth certificates.
Did it show or indicate to you that Frances Matilda Dodge and Frances Lucille Manzer were born on the same day?
No, 3 days difference, I believe it was. My mother, her parents gave her the birth date of November 23rd, 1914. On Frances Dodge's, it was November 27th, 1914. So there's a few days discrepancy.
And now the birth certificate I've got is November 20th.
20th. So there's actually another birth date involved.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. We're going to take a break, and we're going to be back and hear some more stories from friends of the Dodge family, which you've never talked to any of the Dodge members of the Dodge
family. Just John Van Lennep and Pompano.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I've talked to
him. We'll take a break, and we'll be back. That we did not touch on before. You do remember going to the Dodge home.
Oh, yes,
as
I was
a little
taken
girl.
There.
You want to tell us about that?
Well, I was visiting friends in Gatlinburg. They had a chalet up in the mountains, a beautiful, beautiful place. And we were just sitting around, and I said to my daughter, I said, well, I've only been in one home nicer than that. And this was only about 8-10 years ago. And they said, well, where were you, you know, that you were in a home like this? And I said, well, I had been taken to a home on Boston Boulevard when I was a little girl. I'd never thought about it, really, or ever mentioned it. Never even thought about it.
Do you remember anything about the
home? Yes, I remember going there.
Different rooms and the furniture that would be in them?
Mm-hmm. I was taken there as a girl, and they took me up the big staircase up to the bedroom.
How old were you?
I imagine 7 or 8. I'm not sure just what year it was. Mm-hmm.
And then, didn't you visit, wasn't there a old lady that was
in bed, sick.
Who was that?
I don't know. I didn't know at the time. I didn't know even know who they were. And the girl took me back downstairs and set me in a sunroom like it said, a terrazzo floor and plants. And a lady came and gave me milk and cookies, and I sat there. The lady that had taken me went back upstairs.
And you never went through the rest of the house?
No. No, I just went up the stairway to the bedroom and then into the...
So how often were you there and how long would you stay?
I didn't stay too long. That's the only time I ever went.
You were
went
just there to. Once and mm-hmm. you remember that. Mm-hmm. John?
Well, in case you're confused now, wait till we get through talking to our next guest who's sitting out here in the audience. Would you stand, please? Just so we can see you, you are Mabel Burgett. Am I pronouncing that right, Ms. Burgett?
Right.
Your father-in-law was a very good friend of John Dodge's.
Yep.
They went fishing together.
I sure did.
They did some drinking together.
I'd say that, too.
And you wound up having a very important story to tell.
Yeah.
You were told never to talk about this, weren't you?
That's right.
And it's bothered you all your life.
Well... up until I found her.
All right, tell us what you knew.
I was married when I was 17, and I was a farm girl. And my husband brought me to Detroit, and we lived with his parents. So before my baby was born, we used to take walks because I didn't know anyone. I wasn't getting much exercise. So we'd walk over to Hamtramck down Joseph Campbell. And this one day, there's papers, newspapers from all different places, and they had a picture of babies, and they were Siamese twins. And I was just a dumb kid. I did not know what Siamese twins was.
Sure.
So she read part of it, and finally I said to her, what is Siamese twins? Because I didn't know. And she told me and explained to me. So she said, I asked some more questions a little bit, and she said, well, John Dodge fathered Siamese twins.
Now, who are you talking to again?
My mother-in-law.
My mother-in-law.
My husband's mother.
All right.
And so then she I was started asking questions again. And she said, this is hush-hush, we don't talk about it. So I thought, oh boy, I gotta know more of this. Siamese twins, here I'm carrying my child, and is my baby gonna be this way?
Yeah.
So I was doing some thinking, and I knew I wasn't gonna get no answers from her. So I just kept still, and after my baby was born, she was okay.
Did your mother-in-law tell you where she got this story?
From Dad. Dad.
And Dad got it
Dad
from where?
Dad told her. In the shop, from Dodge, on their fishing trips, wherever. It seemed like a lot of people knew the way she had talked to me. That through the shop.
You mean that was a rumor around the shop, and it wasn't as big a secret as John Dodge and Dad thought it was, huh?
I think when they drank, they talked a little bit too much.
I've done that myself, to my eternal regret.
We all do that.
When did you come forward with this story, Mabel?
Well, it went on when I was in the hospital operation, or I had an operation. There was a woman in the bed next to me, and I kept looking at her and looking at her, and I thought, you just look like John Dodge. So one day I got courage enough up, I asked her, could you be adopted? And she said, no. She wasn't adopted. And I said, well, okay. So, but I'm still hunting for her. In my mind, not talking to nobody. Oh, before that, though, after my baby was born, well, I asked Mother, I said, I got to talk to you one more time. I said, was they boys or girls or what? And she said they were girls.
They were girls.
So that's when I started looking for a girl.
How many years went by before you finally met Pat?
About 3 years ago, wasn't it? Or four?
I think it was about 3 or 4.
I was in Florida with my son-in-law and daughter, and they were in the pool, and I was hard up for something to do, and I thought, oh, I'll go to the store and get one of the gossip books, magazines. So.
Sounds like somebody I'm rather close to.
So I got the Globe, and I went back, and I sat by the pool and turned 2 or 3 pages, and there is Mrs. Dodge. I looked at it, and I screamed, Dolly Richard. And he said, what? And I said, I have found her. This is her. So I called him, and we had 3 more days yet.
Mm-hmm.
And I said, take me home now. I don't want to.
Cut short the vacation.
Yep. But they didn't do it.
But you did go home 3 days later.
Yeah.
And you made a contact.
I called her name, her address or nothing. I couldn't get a hold of her, so I called her life. I called John Cunningham. And
her attorney
at the time. And he said, would you be willing to face her, to meet her? And I said, I want her. I couldn't wait till I did. So we met, and before that, though, 2 years before Andy's mother died, my husband's mother died, she gave me some pictures, John Dodge's eulogy, and a picture of the Delphine boat,
mm-hmm.
and a picture of the big shots from Christ from Dodge's,
mm-hmm.
and I don't know how many more. And about 2 years before I met her, I kept these pictures, but don't ask me why, I don't know.
Maybe I got to stop right there.
Yes, we've got to take a break.
Our stories are so long. We'll come back and pick that up.
If you're a Nelson, a Kimball, or a Ferguson, and you know anything about this case, got some hard facts, please give us a call at 298-6161. We'll be right back. This whole story is fraught with coincidences. Further coincidence was the fact that your family, Pat, the Manser family, enjoyed a lot of wealth shortly after you were adopted. Can you talk about that?
Yes, they had been evicted from a home shortly before, in the early fall of 14. And when they got me, they bought and paid for a 7-room house on Hogarth Avenue in Detroit, and my dad had a car, and my mother had lovely clothes, fur coats. And then about 1920, when he died...
Dodge cars?
Hey, pardon?
Dodge cars.
Mm-hmm. In 1920, when he, John Dodge died, we moved to a lesser neighborhood, and I think that our scale of living went down a little.
Mm-hmm. Matilda might have taken over, right?
We moved from there to Stanford. We moved from there to a Stanford address.
Jean, you found this in the research, did you?
Yes. Well, you know,
the rise and fall of the financial status.
She led a very comfortable middle-class life, a little bit above, perhaps, what the ordinary person would. And still there were these strong contrasts. You know, while she was reading the Ruth Fielding book series about girls going to boarding school, the real heiress was actually at a boarding school with her horse and with her governess. So the distance was so wide that saying that she lived a comfortable life is far different from the life led by her so-called twin.
Now the Mansers were a very religious family. Your family
was very religious.
Yeah. Did your mother never say anything about... Didn't she say, though, that you were a biological child? Did she ever?
No, she never came right out and said that. I just presumed I was always.
Sharon, wasn't there another son?
We did find out in the document. The Mansers also adopted a son. My mother was about the age 10 when they adopted a Bob Manser. And in these documents, the Mansers did put my mother as their own biological child. We found this very strange because knowing the Mansers, they were very good religious people and did not believe in lying.
Yeah.
And they did have this on the records of Robert Manser's, Robert Manser's son that they adopted.
Yes.
We surmise that perhaps the reason they did that was, you know, she was such a religious woman and so very moral in every way, and a good mother to Francis, but there was always this distance separating them. They never really close, Francis says. And I surmise, what I know of Mrs. Manser's personality, that this was something that she lived with every day, that she did not tell the truth, and even felt forced to lie on this.
Do you feel that way, Pat?
Yes, I do. Uh-huh. My mother was very strict.
It was also very curious to us how Robert Manser, at that point in time when he wrote his will, decided to let my mother know that she was adopted.
We'll be right back. Once more, if you have any information about Emma Nelson or the Ferguson family, perhaps, or, let's see, I've got to get them all straight. Emma Nelson, who may have lived in Jackson or in Windsor. Or if you are a friend of the Nelson family or the Kimballs, give us a call. Or maybe you know something about them. 298-6161. Marilyn?
You had a question, sir.
Mm-hmm. Is there any way they could use hypnosis to find out what you're blocking, maybe in your subconscious, about what you don't remember at the age of 7 or 8?
I don't know. I told them, the Dodge lawyers, that I would go. At one time, they asked me if I would do that, and I said I would.
Okay. Hi, I'm a big fan, and I read that your adoption was not certified until 1941, and that it was done by the attorney who handled the Dodge wills. Did they give you any reason why they waited so long to certify your adoption?
Well, we never did know that until just last week. Mm-hmm. When we got the papers, and you don't adopt somebody when they're 27 years old, really.
We did attempt to get explanations, but we were closed doors. We never got any explanations of why my mother was adopted at 27 and two children of her own. None of the adoption records are signed by a judge or anyone, even a notary. Mm-hmm.
I have twins myself, and I've done a lot of reading about twins. And I have read that where it used to be in the old days, that especially if it were Siamese twins, they would do away with one or not let it be known. Mm-hmm. Or like if it was a king and the firstborn was supposed to be the king, then they would put the other one in jail and they would never be heard from. Mm-hmm. So I sort of
they say I was born with a cap, like, or a veil. But the it
could have been.
Yeah.
Which in those days was considered to be the sign of the devil.
Devil.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So, see, they thought about them differently then. Yeah.
Yes. Could you talk for just a second about the appeals court decision to open your records? I'm adopted, and I'd like my records open, too, so I'm wondering, you know, what that was about and how that happened.
Well, I hope you have better luck than I did.
Well,
it took me so many years.
You did have them open,
though. 6 years to do it.
I'm willing to do that.
Uh-huh.
What was that process? What was the final decision that made them open your record?
Well, we went to appeals court first, and the appeals court ordered Judge Maher to hear my case, and he refused. So we went back to appeals court again, and this time they said I could have my papers, but we never did have to go back to court again. They overruled Maher and just went over his head.
How many years did that take again?
About six.
We're going to take a break. We'll be back with more from our audience.
Mrs. Mealbach, I have a question for you. Now, I had either heard or read somewhere that there is a possible unclaimed inheritance that's attached to the Dodge will or the Dodge estate. Do you know anything about that?
Yes, there's supposed to be one in Comerica. Every time I go into court, Comerica's there still, right up till the last time. And we've gone down to see the man there, and he told me he would let me know if there was anything there, and he never did call, but we called back, and he said he had to talk to his attorneys.
So you're really getting nowhere. I mean, it doesn't seem like you have anybody that's really fighting for you on your side to help you out.
No, we just don't know, you know, what's going on, really.
No, thank you.
Yes, sir.
Yes, was there ever a blood that you could trace that your twin's blood, like Coleman Young had to do with his baby?
Well, I went to Ann Arbor. I went to Ann Arbor. They asked me to take genetic tests up there. The Dodge family did, and I went there and took them, but I didn't get the results, and they would never show any of Francis's. They refused.
What they did is the family requested my mom in about the first 2 months of her court dealings that she asked her if she would, not the court, but rather the Dodges and their attorneys, if she would go for genealogy and DNA testing up at U of M. She did go, and we were never able, like my mom said, to get the results of the grandchildren. Now, naturally, due to law, she could get her results, but what would we compare them to? Their records are closed to us. They did never use them in court. I have to add that, because that's important. They didn't choose to use them, so I would think that went in my mother's favor.
Okay, Mrs. Mealbach, my question is, when you were growing up, had you ever seen your supposedly sister Frances or your mother around the presence of your Mealbach home?
No,
I mean,
no.
You've never even seen them in existence?
No, never. No, I didn't.
Did that, today, does that puzzle you at all?
Not really.
Okay.
So? How many members of the Dodge family are left nowadays?
Gene, you could probably answer that.
I don't really know.
How many members of
how many members are left?
How many Dodges?
Grandchildren?
Are still around? Mm-hmm. Are still around? Is that
yes,
what
ma'am.
You asked? Well, really, there were none of the John Dodge family locally anymore. There's some down in Lexington, Kentucky. They still have the horse farm's grandchildren. And there's another grandchild out east. And there's really no one around here. There are a few Horace Dodge descendants. The family does not know a lot about its origins, and when my book came out, they were very interested in reading and learning about the family. As a matter of fact, the John Dodge granddaughter commissioned me to write a monograph on John Dodge for Meadowbrook Hall.
We'll take a break. We'll be right back.
We're back, and you're Linda. You're Pat's daughter. How do you feel about this? We haven't heard from you.
Well, I feel it sort of unnerving at times because of going through all the legal complications and stuff. We've had representations. However, I don't feel that that representation has been just gung-ho on the whole thing. I've seen so much more gung-ho on so many other cases like King Boots, like all these other different things, you know, that I just... Well, I think we need some more backing as far as representation.
You talk about legal representation.
Legal representation, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Since Mom has had a birth certificate given her, being a birth certificate that just wouldn't be acceptable by any of the courts that she's been through,
mm-hmm.
you know, they just put thumbs down on things like that, you know, that maybe if we had someone else that... could really get involved in it and, you know, try and sort out all these little different discrepancies, all the different things from the adoption papers to the birth certificate to the people, you know, it's just...
What's the one thing that really... Now, you're the son. You're the son. What is the one thing that both of you say, this has got to be conclusive? What's the one thing? There's so many things.
Other than the resemblances in the papers and just the way that everybody has covered this up all along, you know, made me believe in
it. You think it's a big cover-up?
Yes, I do.
How many else think it's a big cover-up? How many don't? Anybody on my side does not think this is a cover-up? How about that? John? Anybody on your side?
Only enough to say we'll be right back after this.
Well, to say the least, this is fascinating. I'll tell you, I'm really into it, and I think you know how our audience feel. I'm convinced. I want to thank Eugene very much for being with us, and Sharon and Pat. Go get them, please, you know? I just really...
Jean Madden Petrone's book is called Tangled Web, The Legacy of Auto Pioneer John F. Dodge. It is fascinating reading. Get it now in your bookstore.
I know.
You'll love it. By the way, if you know some information that might help Pat, but you did want to tell us on the air for one reason or another, we're going to give you a number where you can reach Pat's family that will be on the Kelly & Company hotline beginning at about 11 o'clock.
I think
you got
so.
Any time for any more questions?
Yep,
yes,
we'll
let's just keep going
until
we run out of time. I had this woman standing up over here.
Three quick questions. If you were a Siamese twin, is there any history that your mom... I would assume she'd have to have a C-section, having Siamese twins. Is there any history of twins in the family? And how big were you at birth? If you were ill, I was curious how big your sister was and how much did you weigh?
I haven't any idea. Does it say on the birth certificate?
It doesn't give any. We've obtained no medical information. The adoption records did have a section, a quite large section for medical information. It was completely left blank.
But did you know who the doctor was?
Well, we have so far two different doctors of birth, so there's
another friend of the family.
Yeah.
Another, they're
yeah.
all friends. A lot of communal friends there.
Yeah, this man had lots of friends.
Pat, do you have plans to go after them in court for your inheritance?
I imagine if there's something left in the trust, I wouldn't, not for the grandchildren or the money, you know, the money that they had coming, no, not that. But if there's supposed to be some in trust, that's what the lawyers have told me from the beginning, that I didn't want to get into this. I absolutely refused when the ad litem for the Dodge family...